feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
Welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, visionary talk radio on GCR Progressive Internet Radio. Fear rocking your world.
And welcome to Mo Banshee's Lair, visionary talk radio on GCR Inspirational Radio, with Internet Radio, one of the best stations on the Internet. Tonight I have a rocking show for everybody. I know you guys are going to love this. We have Ansel Faraj coming back again, joining us to talk about his movie Dr. Mabuse, which is being released now. And we also have the stars of this incredible movie, and they're waiting as well. We have Jerry Lacy, who is the star and the arch villain, and then we have Nathan Wilson and Derek Mobratton. And so we're going to bring them all on. I want to welcome everybody listening on all the players. I want to welcome everybody listening that's in the chat room. And if you have a problem listening, or, you know, somebody in the chat room can help you. I just want to remind everybody that everybody knows I'm a huge animal advocate. All the animal shelters all over are just being inundated with animals, because as the economy falters, people are dropping their pets off at shelters. And please try, if you know somebody who's in that kind of position, try to convince them to take them to a no-kill shelter. The other thing I would ask is if you can drop off a bag of dog food, cat food, litter at your local shelters. You know, we blow $10 at McDonald's and don't give it a second thought. Maybe if you can't have, like, I can't have dogs here, only if it's like a service dog. So I try to help the animal shelters, the dogs that are there. And it's a really cool way to help. And if you love animals but can't have animals, and maybe are really, you know, healthy and able to walk animals, going to a shelter and pitching in and walking the dogs and helping them out and playing with the cats is really a wonderful way to pay it forward and help animals in shelters. I can't say how upset I am at all the people abandoning older dogs and cats, because obviously, just like us, as they get older, they start having some trouble, and people are like, I can't afford to pay for their health care. And it's unfortunate, and I'm hoping people who are generous and good-hearted, like my listeners, will step in and get up to the plate. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on Crazy But News, even though there's a million Crazy But News stories out there. I want to talk about this movie, which I'm over the moon about. Dr. Mabuse, a hypnotist, a genius, a criminal mastermind. He was there before Lex Luthor. Lex Luthor probably could take some really good cues from Dr. Mabuse. He's before Fu Manchu, man. A really bad guy, and you do not want this guy in his head. So I'm going to start with Ansel. Welcome back to the lair.
Thank you very much, Mel.
And you want to introduce everybody that's with us?
Yes. Tonight we also have my actors, Jerry Lacy, who plays Dr. Mabuse. And
say hello, Jerry.
Hello.
And Nathan Wilson, who is Inspector Carl Lohemann.
Hello.
And Derek Mobratton, who is Tom Smith.
Hello.
Welcome to the lair, gentlemen. I am over the moon to meet all of you. Ansel, this is an old book that was turned into movies, famous movies for their time, and then they kind of went to sleep, and everybody kind of forgot about Dr. Mabuse. What turned you onto him?
I really like the idea of this villain who is a master, a criminal mastermind. He's a master of hypnosis, a master of disguise. He's just a very fascinating character. And you know, how exactly does he work, and what's his ultimate agenda? And his ultimate agenda is not to rule the world, but to take over the world and then destroy it and rule the ashes of the world. And that's very demented for a villain. That's not something you see quite often in literature or movies or what have you. And so I was always sort of fascinated by this character. And when I was 17, I decided I was going to write my own story about him, and I wrote this script. And 3-4 years later, I'm not good at math, we finally made the movie. So that's how it kind of happened.
And you approached who first? Jerry first?
I approached, from the Dark Shadows cast, I approached Catherine. Actually, I did approach Jerry first. I just didn't hear from Jerry for a while. But I approached Jerry first, and with the idea of him playing Dr. Mabuse, and I didn't hear from him for about a month, I believe. And in the course of that month, I managed to convince Kathryn Lee Scott to come on board of the film, and began negotiations to get Laura Parker to play a role in the film. So, yeah.
Yeah. So Jerry, you are you've got that voice. You've got that voice. You've got the voice of a real bad guy. I guess you know that from Reverend Trask, right?
Yes, that helped. That helped. But the older you get, the more your voice sounds anyway.
Yeah, you know, the more you yell at kids and the more you say, oh, for crying out loud, you know, the lower it gets. And you really learn how to use it in an ominous tone, you know. Go ahead.
I was just going to say that Ansel had a lot to do with the voice that I use as Dr. Mabuse. He wanted him to be gravelly voiced and soft spoken because there's no reason for Dr. Mabuse ever to yell. He's in total command all the time.
Mm-hmm. Nathan, you're the good guy in this. This year, Inspector Carl Lohemann, and you said he's an idealist a little bit, maybe.
Yeah, he wants to believe that he can change the world. Or, I mean, he himself can help out people, I guess, to change the world. Kind of like a younger person would believe that he's a go-getter and he just wants to go out there and fight the bad guys and win and take down the bad guys, I guess.
This is like a major breakthrough for you?
Yes. To this date. Yeah, this is my biggest role thus far, having just been premiered on a big screen down in San Diego. So me and Ansel shot a film maybe, I think, 3 or 4 months before this film. And that's how I met Ansel. It was a comedy called Brother Drop Dead. And then he asked me to be in this as Carl Lohemann, and now here we are.
Mm-hmm. And Derek, you're also a younger actor, right? And you played Tom Smith. And what is Tom Smith's role?
Tom Smith is sort of the right-hand man of Dr. Mabuse. And his main goal is just to be Dr. Mabuse and kind of, you know, is second in charge in a sense. But yes, I am young to this acting realm, and this would be my first feature film. So yes, very young.
Well, I think it's going to be, I mean, from what I've heard of people who saw this, because Ansel, you just had this at the Dark Shadows reunion thing festival, and you showed it, right?
Yeah, we sort of organized, or Jim Pearson and Lance Alsbaugh, they sort of put together this whole weekend event for Dr. Mabuse. And we just had our world premiere on Saturday, and to a sold-out crowd. And I'm getting the reviews in right now, and really great, wonderful reviews, which means a lot to me. You know, we all worked so hard on the film, and put so much time and effort, and you know, passion into the thing, and so it's really great to have such a wonderful response, and we're thrilled, I'm thrilled.
I'm thrilled that you're here, and I hear it's great. And don't forget the forum in Metuchen. He's anxious to maybe air the film, you know, and show it there. You know, I think you've got a great cast. I mean, you've got seasoned Jerry. You played against Sam. You were Bogart. Yes, you were Bogart, and you were amazing in it because. It was light and it was kind of funny, even though Bogart was supposed to be very serious, but it was such a departure from the cruel Reverend Trask or the, you know, manipulative guy. You surprised everybody with that role. You're a phenomenal actor.
Well, thank you very much. That's what we like about acting, you know, is the ability to play different parts as you go through your career.
You can be many people, right?
Yep. Can be anybody you want to be, as long as somebody will hire
you to
do it.
Yeah, and you can be a right old murderer. And it's
right.
Okay. You can wall people up behind brick walls and still go to the grocery store the next day and not get in trouble for it.
That's right.
I still cannot get over at the festival last year when... somebody got up and asked you, you know, how you got out from behind the wall when you got walled up in there, and your face was kind of like, excuse me? and the place got quiet. Well, how did you get out? And you said, oh, there was an opening back there. It was just a prop.
Yeah.
I was dying because people... Dark Shadows, it's a cult now. It's like that Rocky Horror motion picture thing with Tim Curry. It has a cult following. It does. There are people, you see, I got involved with the Vietnam thing and, you know, moving around from base to base, and I kind of lost touch with it. But there were people that followed that right on through to the bitter end and will argue points of that show, which to me means it made a cultural impact. What do you think?
Well, quite clearly, and we had people down at the convention this past weekend in Coronado Island, San Diego, that were fifth generation Dark Shadows watchers. You believe that?
Mm. Yeah,
five
I do.
Generations. From grandfathers to great-grandfathers to little children are being shown Dark Shadows now by their grandfathers, creating a whole new audience.
You also, I want to mention it before we get too far into this, you also have a like CD up for sale and the proceeds go to animal shelters of your choice, right? Do
That's
you want to
correct,
tell everybody
yes.
about it?
Well, each time we go to a convention, I sell my CDs and I also have autographed pictures. That I sell all of the proceeds from that goes to various animal shelters. There's a no kill shelter in the valley out here in California that I use occasionally. This last one was for the American what's it called, the American Bird Sanctuary or something like that.
Awesome.
So I don't,
awesome,
I don't, man. I don't stick to just pets. I do all animals. Mm-hmm. I gave to orangutans one year. We move it around, but it's always animals. Yes.
Yeah, and if somebody wanted to get a hold of you, you have your own site that they can maybe get a hold of and buy the CD.
Yes. Well, actually, Gloria Lillibridge sells them. On Facebook or on eBay, actually, on eBay. So they can be found there, yeah.
And these are classic stories. They're scary stories. They're that kind of thing. Ghost stories.
Well, I was just going to say it's some of my favorite poetry and some of my favorite old ghost stories. I think there are about right. five ghost stories, and the rest are good old good poetry, the kind of poetry that guys like.
Mm-hmm.
The Raven, the shooting of mm-hmm. Dan McGrew, the face on the barroom floor, and
Very
things
cool.
like that.
Very cool. And again, if anybody wants to get a hold of it, I guess if they go to Amazon or eBay or one of those and just Google your name, they're going to find it, you know.
On eBay, so on eBay, definitely. Yes.
Yeah.
On eBay for
okay.
sure, yes.
Yeah. The story, Ansel, the story of Dr. Mabuse. Now this is a story. There were three movies made back in, you know, there were three books. Mabuse, Dr. Mabuse the Gambler, The Testament of Dr. Mabuse, Dr. Mabuse Colony. Okay,
right.
But your story is a totally new story, right?
It's completely original. I took the basic character and I took elements of the character that I liked of him, and I sort of deconstructed him and then put him back together in my own sort of form of Dr. Mabuse. So even the character is my interpretation of the character. It's not the Norbert Jacques, Fritz Lang character that you would be seeing. It's my own sort of creation. And the story is completely original. It's not a remake, reboot, sequel, adaptation, or whatever you want to call it. Whatever they call things
mm-hmm.
these days, and it's a lot of fun. It's a dark film noir apocalyptic thriller, and yeah.
Okay, you've got Catherine Lee Scott. She's Madame Von Harbo.
Madame Von Harbo. Yeah.
Harbo, and then you've got Lara Parker, and she's also
Madame
there.
Feroza,
what
yes.
what are they like? Henchmen waiting for him to come back.
They
worshippers.
They are two. Now I can talk about it. The film is coming out. They are two sisters.
Right.
And there might be a third sister. And they are psychic, and they may or may not be working for Dr. Mabuse, or they may be helping Inspector Lohemann. Or they may have their own agenda. And
mm-hmm.
very interesting characters. And I don't want to get into it too much because there's quite a bit of mystery around these two women. And yeah, I can't say about it. I can't talk about it too much. But
right.
And Catherine
okay.
and Laura are fantastic in the film. Catherine, you're used to seeing Catherine play the good girl, like on Dark Shadows. And in this film, she's quite different. She might be a villain. And Laura is amazing, as always. And they had a lot of fun making the film, and they are fantastic in the movie.
Mm-hmm. Well, Laura, she uses that laugh. Everybody knows Angelique's laugh. And it's the laugh that only she can do. And Catherine Lee Scott, after being held a sex slave town in a vampire's basement for 6 years, she's entitled to be a bad girl.
Yeah.
I mean, really, let's get real, guys. The guy had her locked down in the basement, you know. And she wasn't a willing blood donor either. But, yeah, that was a strange storyline with that, but it was fun. Nathan, you're the Inspector Lohemann, and obviously you get pulled into some kind of intrigue somehow. Let me just ask, is the inspector new to Dr. Mabuse, or is he already aware at the beginning of Dr. Mabuse?
He's aware of Dr. Mabuse. I can talk a little bit longer.
A little bit.
Just a little bit.
Well, he knows, he's aware of Dr. Mabuse in the beginning. He doesn't know of the power of Dr. Mabuse, and a person that he was under in the department was after Dr. Mabuse. And something happened to him,
mm-hmm.
and Dr. Mabuse kind of went away for a while, and now he's back, and he he gets given this case again because he's the only person in the city that knows anything about Dr. Mabuse. So he's kind of sucked in to this case by not really wanting to do it because he's a little bit afraid, I think, of him and what could happen. But he's generally kind of forced into it. And then once he's in it, he dives into trying to figure out what's going on.
Let's talk about, you know, costumes and stuff. You know, there's a whole huge chemistry for making a movie that I don't understand. I'm not an actress. I never aspired to be an actress. I just sang in a choir. But movies, you've got to get wardrobe right. So what time zone are we talking? Is it the present?
No, it's sort of in its own little world of, like 1920s, 1930s, 1940s. It's its own world in a city that we never say the name of. It's as I describe it, it kind of takes place in like a universal monster netherworld, you know, where you know everybody's got different accents and you're never quite sure if it's the 1800s or the 1940s. And there's modern technology and then there's like steampunk technology and yeah, it's definitely a period piece, I guess, when you get to the bottom of it.
Jerry, did you have to, like, get makeup for this?
We did a little bit of makeup, not too much. Do it mostly with my face.
Yeah, long hair. I saw the one clip, which I'm going to play the audio for in like a minute, where there appears to be a man in a cape running away with longish hair. I'm going to assume that's either you or a vagrant or somebody.
It is somebody, yes.
That actually.
It is somebody, right? It's somebody. It's not the invisible man. Okay, we're going to go to a break, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to play my promo and then the Dr. Mabuse official teaser trailer, and then I've got a surprise clip of Jerry Lacy in Play It Again, Sam, doing Bogart. If you're listening to this on a radio or speaker, you got to turn it off or we get a feedback. With that, we're going to be right back, and I hope you guys all enjoy this.
There's no place like home. There's no place like home.
There's no place like home. There's no place like home.
This is Mo inviting you to visit me at my lair. Mo Banchi's Lair Visionary Talk Radio airs every Tuesday night live on GCRInternetRadio.com. Tune in at 9 p.m. Eastern Time Zone. Topics A to Z, Mo Banchi's Lair on GCR Internet Radio. We're rocking your world.
Just try to stay out of my way. Just try. I'll get you, my pretty, and your little dog, too.
Once more. as men knew it once, long ago. And this time, they will never forget it. Permit me to introduce myself. My name is Mabuse. Dr. Mabuse.
Take care, Inspector. These are strange times.
Short. I never seem to bother anybody.
You're starting off on the wrong foot, kid.
Yeah, negative, you mean.
Sure. You're letting her get the best of you before the game even starts. Say, what's that stuff you was putting on your face?
That's Canoe. It's an aftershave lotion.
Yeah? What about all that other stuff?
That's Lavoris, Menin spray deodorant, and Johnson & Johnson baby powder.
For Christ's sake, kid, you're gonna smell like a French cat house.
I need them.
Why? You ashamed to sweat?
I want to make an impression.
You know, kid, somewheres in life you got turned around. It's her job to smell nice for you. Whatever you do, don't tell her you don't drink. She'll think you're a Boy Scout. And don't get nervous. The only bad break you could get is if she turns out to be a virgin or a cop.
My luck should turn out to be both. You know he's right. A lot of women are turned on by a...
And welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair. I hope you enjoyed that, because that last clip was Jerry Lacy in a movie called Play It Again, Sam, where he is the spirit of Bogart helping whatever his name is, Alan's character get a girl in the sack. Basically, and it's really funny, and I just told Jerry I'm not a Woody Allen fan, and the only reason I watch that is because I get such a charge out of his portrayal of Bogart, which is amazing. So kudos to you, because otherwise I would never watch that movie, Jerry.
Well, I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Thank you. It is the only thing that saves it for me. But you were awesome in it, and you are renowned now for being a Bogart impressionist. How did that happen?
It happened in college. I did a play where I played a gangster, and people came backstage and told me that I looked like Humphrey Bogart, and so I decided to try and work on his voice, and I did that. And then when the play came up in New York, I got an audition for it and landed the part. It's as easy as that.
Cool. Yeah, I have to say something. I think being an actor or an actress or a director or anything in show business, I said it to Chris Penick, it has to be, I think, one of the hardest ways to make a living that anybody could choose, and I'm going to ask each one of you for your thoughts on that. Because Chris Penick, I says, well, you have a daughter, what did you tell her? And he says, I told her, don't go into show business. That's what I told her. He says, it is. It's a really hard. Jerry, you, what do you think about it being a hard business?
Oh, I get to go first, huh? All right.
Well, yeah, I think because your name starts with J.
So far, Jerry, so you can go first.
All right.
For a living, anyway.
Well, it is. It's incredibly hard. It's one of the hardest businesses to make a living at that there is. There are thousands and thousands of actors who are professional actors but never, ever make a living doing it, because there just aren't enough parts for all the people who want to be actors. I have two children, one of which is going into the business. He's He's getting started now in Los Angeles. His name is Danny Lacy, and he's done a couple of commercials. He's very, very good at improv, and he's studying now and starting to do a little work at the same time. So,
an actress, too. Your wife's an actress, too, right?
Yes. Yes, she is. That's right.
And you want to tell them who she is?
Well, Julia Duffy, yes. And she is an actress. I just wanted to say, you know, young people who are getting into the business have a lot of hope and a lot of heartache in front of them. But one thing that I can always say to give them some good advice is if they really believe in it and they really want to do it, perseverance is one of the very, very best things. Just keep at it. Mm-hmm. Keep working. The more you do, the better you get. Mm-hmm. Hang in there.
I would imagine also being a watcher, a people watcher, is got to be a big bonus because you learn from other people. Just watching everyday things, right?
Oh, sure. Absolutely. You develop characters. You can spot people while you're sitting in a bus station and watch the way they walk, they talk, they behave, and put it in your repertoire.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we're going to ask Derek. Derek, how about you? Do you find it's rougher than you thought?
You know, I would argue that it's definitely a way of life, and it's not something that you can kind of do on the side. But stories like this, like Dr. Mabuse, makes it worthwhile and makes all the heartache, you know, kind of pay off when you're able to kind of fulfill the story and serve the story in a way that changes people in you know, with a good movie.
Mm-hmm. And Nathan?
I think for me, I've been out here a little while now, and you know, I've tossed back and forth all the time about, you know, should I quit this game or should I go do something else, or, you know, I made a little money here, or you seem like you're starting to get a step and you feel like you're getting going, and then something happens to kind of drag you down. And it's just a lot of ups and downs and a roller coaster, but usually by the end of the day, I don't know what else I would do. I don't know what else I'm that passionate about to go out and do to want to make a living at and to be happy with my life about what I'm doing. So I usually just stick around and keep doing it because I have a lot of fun doing it. I also do improv as well, and I love doing that. I love being on the stage. So,
yeah, there's a certain void that happens when you don't do the acting thing, and you think you can get away with it, but you can never.
And then it's always there. Like, you'll be away for a month or two, and then you always get that itch back of, like, you want to be on stage, mm-hmm. or you want to be watching people like Jerry or whoever says, you go out and check out people, and you want to go and kind of interpretate your vision of who that person was.
Right. You know, I was thinking about this today with you, and the movie Field of Dreams came to me, and the character Shoeless Joe Jackson, when he said, "Hell, I would have played for free, just to play." Mm-hmm. I imagine it's got to be that strong. And I also remember Sarah Karloff. When her father, Boris, she was talking to me, and she said he took her into Broadway to watch him do Captain Hook, Peter Pan. And he had her stand behind in the whatever it is, the little back of the stage watching. And he came out finally after like a week of it and said, "I can see that it isn't burning in your belly, so you're never going to be an actress." He already knew by looking at her and the way she was reacting to all the work and how boring. I guess if you're not turned on by makeup and lights and all of that, you're in the wrong business, huh?
Yeah, I agree.
I would agree with that, yes.
Yeah. There has to be a passion in there somewhere for it and to be in front of the people and to try to make it actually. I start to think of it as an art form. You know, some people paint and kind of express themselves that way. Some people write, some people draw. And I guess for us, our art form would be to interpret people and show people what we think of the world through our acting.
And that sort of comes innately, too, because if you ask Ansel about the movies that he's been making movies since he was a young kid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what do you think, Ansel?
Ansel, yes, you have... I saved you for last because you had the dubious honor of being the director, the writer, the producer. It all falls on your shoulders. At the end of the day, you're paying the bills. It can't be easy on you at all, huh?
No, and at times it is very, very stressful. And, you know, at times I'm like, oh, what am I doing? You know, and even when you're filming, I said the other day to David Selby, when you're making a movie, it's an uphill battle, and he agreed with me completely, because you're constantly... you're fighting whatever obstacle comes in your way. But there's a movie from the 40s. It's a British film called The Red Shoes by Michael Powell and Emmerich Pressburger. And it's about this ballet dancer who joins this ballet group, and she becomes so obsessed with her performing this play, The Red Shoes. And there's a line in the film where the ballet master asks her, why do you want to dance? And she responds with, why do you want to live? And I think that sort of defines what we do. Why do you want to act, or why do you want to write or direct? And the answer is, why do you want to live? And I think it's because we have no choice. This is what we're supposed to do. And, you know, despite all the pitfalls and the drama and heartache that comes with this business, we just have this drive to create something, to make something, and to entertain people and to tell stories. And if we're not doing that, we're not really living. I don't know, that might sound really philosophical or what have you, but that's
I think it was beautifully put, Ansel.
I do. I think you did well. let me ask you, you see, you're an independent filmmaker.
Right.
And so basically you're bucking up against studio, which obviously there's a big thing called money.
Yes.
That's a difference.
Yes.
And so now independent, and a lot of new movies are coming out independent. Even big studios are sending movies out and doing stuff like that to independents. How's it work for money? What do you get, investors?
Well, yeah, I mean, once again, it really depends on the film. I have to say, I feel personally that independent cinema is kind of the original independent cinema that began in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, and continued when Robert Redford began Sundance and whatnot. That sort of form of independent cinema, in my opinion, I feel is dying. Because that is slowly becoming more and more corporate. You're getting more and more big A-lister films, actors in these films. The films are getting, you know, higher budgets and winning, you know, Academy Awards for Best Picture and whatnot. And the original sort of form of independent cinema, I think it's moving from the theaters, the art house theaters, and onto the internet. And becoming sort of a form of new media, because independent cinema at the end of the day today, you still kind of need studio backing in order to get a film off the ground.
And a lot of the independent films that are going on these days with the A-listers and everything like that, their budgets are, I mean, $5 million, $10 million, or maybe even a couple million, probably not even a couple million, where the real independent films I feel anymore are made for $50,000 or something. If you could do something amazing with $10,000 to $15,000 to $5,000, you really have something there, I believe.
Yeah, and we barely even had $10,000 on Dr. Mabuse, but you find a way to make it work. And
that's what I believe, like, real independent films should be, and
yeah,
where they were at the heart of everything, I believe.
Yeah, exactly. Nate said it perfectly.
Okay, Ghost in the chat, one of the chatters is asking, Yeah, how do they raise backing for such a project in a really tight world? I mean, did you sell everything you owned, Ansel? Because, you know, $10,000 to me is like, I got to go on a corner and hook or something, man. You know, it ain't happening, you know. It's a lot of money, and I'm sure a lot of it comes right out of your pocket, right?
Yeah, my family has always been supportive of my filmmaking, and so they invested, really. And that's sort of like one of the rules in Hollywood, never put your own money in your own project. Use someone else's, but in this case, you know, I have to use my own money. My family, you know, put up what we could.
And I think in a time like today as well, if you, with all the A-listers and all the people that, I mean, especially for the younger people like us, to be able to get your foot in the door anymore to show people what you have to do, because I was out here for a while trying just to be an actor, and it's really tough to get in there, so you kind of have to...
Well, you've been doing this for 9 years.
Yeah, I've been out here for 9 years now, and after a while I was getting sick of going to auditions, doing this, maybe getting a call back, and a couple times I'd get to the end of like getting a major role, and then something would happen to it because it was kind of independent films. But I just took it upon myself to be like, I'm going to have to spend some money, and I'm going to have to try to do something with somebody to get myself out there. So
that's
kind
of... You see, Disney makes their stars. They take those babies, put them on those sitcoms, and they make their stars, and they keep them. But people who are independent and coming out that didn't get, you know, the Disney treatment, they kind of... They're on their own, you know. It's up to their resourcefulness to get parts and stuff. Another question from the chat. Stanley is asking, is the film being distributed in 35mm or via digital?
It's digital presentation. The film was shot digital, but it looks like film. That's something I really strive to get, that film appearance, because I hate the look of just... standard digital. It looks wrong to me, and it definitely would not fit the period of Dr. Mabuse. But the film is it's being distributed in digital. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So let me and I know we're bouncing around now because we're taking questions, but it kind of the commercial, or you know, the promo for it reminds me a little bit of a noir type of, you know, that kind of,
yeah, exactly.
I keep expecting to see, you know, one of the like Bogart or James
Cagney.
Well,
we Cantony do have Bogart.
Well, yes, you do. You do. You have a very good Bogart. But like Fred McMurray, you know, that kind of thing,
right.
That darkish, so that obviously did influence you. Yes.
Type of film. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. That it's got that kind of feel, huh?
Yeah. Noir. I'm always a huge fan of noir. Ever since I was young, and the style of film noir really lends itself to Dr. Mabuse and to the characters. And also, that's just how my mind works. I automatically think the noir. Archetypes, and then also the comic book feel. Definitely, it was definitely described as a film noir when I was pitching it to people.
I think it was a gothic
film noir
thriller.
Noir, yeah,
kind of what we is
what it is.
Mm-hmm. We have a question for Jerry, and Ansel, you may want to cover your ears, okay? Mm-hmm. For Jerry from Lily in the chat. Jerry, does Ansel compare to other directors you've worked with? How does he stack up as a director?
He has a lot to learn yet. He is very, very good with actors. He knows how to get what he wants out of them without being... how do you say this? Without being nasty. You know, some directors don't really know how to talk to actors, and they just resort to saying something like, something, I won't use that kind of language here.
Derogatory, yeah. They say something that is not a nice way to approach people, right?
That's right.
I always tell my children there's a way to tell somebody to go to hell without actually saying to them, go to hell, you know?
Well,
you
that's correct. And Ansel has that ability. He has that ability to translate what he wants into words that an actor can understand without feeling put upon or
right.
you know, put down.
Yeah, I would imagine it's like any other job. When you've got a superior, sometimes they let that idea, you know, I'm running this show, and they kind of berate the actors and actresses, or they make them feel like, well, you know, you're not up to it, that, you know, and that's trouble on any kind of work thing. I remember reading about Lon Chaney Jr. Going to heads with directors who, you know, just thought he was a big dumb guy, and yes, he was. He was one of the best big dumb guys in Of Mice and Men. You know, he was a great actor.
Right.
You know, and you know, he would go up against some of these directors and say, look, you know, I'm not a chump here. I'm a seasoned actor here. I'm going to give Ansel his due too. How is it like to direct someone like Jerry?
At first it was terrifying, because, you know, I'm a Dark Status fan, and Reverend Trask is staring at me, waiting for me to tell him to do something.
And he has bricks, right? He's got bricks.
Yeah, he does. But it was, I don't know, I think it was very symbiotic. We talked quite a bit before we actually met, conversing through emails about the character of Mabuse and, you know, what he would be like, what he would look like, how he would sound. And so when we got there to you know, the first day of filming, it was a bit nerve-wracking, just because it's the first day, it's always first day nerves, but I don't think it was very hard. It was just, you know, point the camera at Jerry, tell him where to stand, say action, and watch him go to work. It was very easy, but that's what happens when you've got such a talented, experienced actor you know, working with you. You know, I don't know, maybe Jerry can put some more input to this. But,
well, yeah, I can say one other thing. One of the things that made it so easy was that Ansel is extremely well organized. He knew exactly what he wanted to shoot. He knew what scenes. He knew how long it was going to take. And it was actually one of the easiest shoots I've ever done. Everything was so smooth, laid out, and done on time. And in fact, ahead of time, a lot of days.
Yeah, we would finish earlier than planned.
Mm-hmm. We do have another question from Lily. Why isn't there a consonant pronunciation of the name Mabuse?
This comes up all the time. Okay, Ansel, you answer that one.
The correct German pronunciation of Mabuse is Mabuse. The French version is Mabuse, and the American version is Mabuse. So, in the film, it was initially supposed to be Mabuse. I went to a French school, and I speak some French, so that's how I said that's how the character should be called, Mabuse. But then, you know, during filming, things do get a bit rushed, and everybody has their own idea of how the character's name is pronounced. So it's said several different ways throughout the film, but I liked that about it because the character of Dr. Mabuse is so elusive. Nobody knows who he is exactly. Nobody, you know, knows where he's come from. So he's sort of the boogeyman for everybody, and everybody has their own idea of what the boogeyman is. So in its own weird way, the pronunciation of the name differs by the person, and so it's like they have their own interpretation of who they think Dr. Mabuse is. So there really is no correct way of saying his name. It's however you want to say it.
It's kind of, Dr. Mabuse reminds me a bit of Moriarty in the Sherlock Holmes, you know.
Moriarty was a huge influence on the creation of Dr. Mabuse.
And he's a bad guy.
Yes, very bad.
Yeah. Yeah, and the thing with him also is, for a lot of it, you hear the word, the name, but you never, ever make a contact with it. And then suddenly there's a story surrounding him, and he's right there in the face of the hero. We've got like a few minutes before we go to break. The festivals, you were talking about the Sundance thing and all, and I was talking to a couple of other people who make these independent films, and it's really, how hard is it to get these movies into these festivals? Because I kind of see these festivals as another political thing, you know, where, you know, certain movies get in and others don't, you know.
Yes,
how hard is it to get them in?
It's very, very tough. I don't want to sound too, I have to speak carefully here, but yeah, I would say there's a fair amount of politics involved in when festivals pick films. But it's extremely tough. I actually have to say, I've done 20 some films so far, and out of 20, only two have ever been to a festival. One of them was a very strange H.P. Lovecraft-inspired film, Hunters of the Dark, that got screened in Argentina for Halloween last year. It was kind of odd. And then just recently, my comedy that I did with Nathan Wilson, Brother Drop Dead, was screened in New York at the Buffalo Niagara Film Festival. And I won an award for that. I won honorable mention for best comedic writing on that. So it was, it's very, very tough to get into festivals. And we submitted Doctrine of Abuse to several film festivals. And, you know, we're just sitting around here hoping for the best, hoping that it will be accepted and screened across the country, because I know a lot of fans want to see the film. And festivals, you know, we do have theatrical distribution, and it's only in L.A., in Los Angeles, at the moment. So festivals are our best bet for seeing the film across the country.
And it usually it tends to get expensive. I mean, to enter them into all these separate festivals. I mean, it's $50 to $100 per each festival that you submit it to. So it can be expensive in the long run there as well.
Yeah, so say you submit it to six different festivals, you just spent an entire... You just used our entire budget on Doctrine of Abuse sending the movie to festivals.
Really?
So
they charge you to send in a sample?
And there's always that 50-50 chance that you're going to get in and that you're not going to get in. So it's luck, really. And fate decides to smile on you that you get in.
One question before we go on the break and play one of the soundtrack songs from it. And again, Lily is asking, are any of the films on DVD?
Of my films? No, they are available to watch on YouTube for free. If you just type up Hollinsworth Productions in the search banner, you'll find the Hollinsworth Productions channel, and you can see a whole bunch of my work. You know, some of them is most of the movies that are out there I did when I was younger with friends from high school. I'm only 21 years old, so there, you know, a lot of it was done when I was in high school, and then there's a couple that as the years go by they get better as I mature as a filmmaker and I get professional actors, but no, nothing is available on DVD, but it is available to watch on your computer or laptop or tablet or whatever you have for free on the internet.
And with that, I'm going to play Bill Wandel is the one who wrote the soundtrack. Did he write the whole soundtrack?
He wrote an absolutely fantastic score for the film, a completely original score, Bill Wandel.
Very good.
It's a great score. Yes.
Okay, so we're going to do Stan's promo for his show. And Stan does Jurassic Park here on GCR. And he takes the old bones of rock and roll and he plays them and then he puts them back where he found them. And then we're going to play the opening for Dr. Mabuse, written by Bill Wandel, and I hope you guys are really going to enjoy this. I'm still new with this guy's stuff, so everybody just...
Welcome to Jurassic Park.
Well, hello there. This is Stan, inviting you to listen to Jurassic Park, where we dig up the old bones of rock and roll, 50s, 60s, 70s, and beyond, and then carefully rebury them. Thursday nights, 8 Eastern, on GCR.
Welcome back to Mo Banshee's Lair. We'll be talking to Ansel Faraj, Jerry Lacy. We're talking to, and let me bring up the names, Nathan Wilson and Derek. And I know I'm going to screw this name up again. But Derek O'Broughton, Mo Broughton. And they are starring in Dr. Mabuse. So let me ask you, we were talking about the Sal Litvak Saving Lincoln. You used the same idea of a green screen?
Yes, we had a blue screen, actually.
Okay.
A blue screen, sort of a soundstage with a blue screen cyclorama around it. There was no sort of real locations. We did have an apartment, a friend's apartment that we filmed at, but the rest of the film, like 98% of the film, was shot in front of a blue screen.
Let me ask you.
It was a kind of smaller blue screen as well. It was about 10x8, I believe, is how big the room was.
Yeah, so I'm going to go in order again because I want to get everybody's impression of this. Jerry, it's a big difference from having an actual stage with all the props everywhere you need them, and all. How was it to work with this kind of a stage?
Well, it's a bit limiting, you know, because actors always rely on props. If there's something around to lean on, you know, they'll lean on it. For sure, but it's also kind of freeing in a way because you can use your imagination and just let it go wild. You don't have anything to confine you except for the size of the room, which in this case was very confining. It was about 8 feet across, I believe, 8 to 10 feet, And when you were supposed to be walking down a long hallway, you didn't have very far to go. But when it got all put together, it was astounding how real it looks. And
okay,
I've done this before. We use green screen on Dark Shadows from time to time as well, and I've done it other places too.
Yeah, it's not a new concept, but it's getting a lot of use now because, Ansel, it's cost-effective, right?
It's very, very cheap and cost-effective and very time-efficient to do blue screen. But if you gave me the choice to have, you know, sets built and a full soundstage with all these sets, I would definitely pick sets. Just because it's so rare these days to actually get, you know, fully built and dressed sets. Because everybody is doing blue screen. Unfortunately, with the limited resources I have, we have to do blue screen.
So are the pictures, like, painted on? Are they photographs? How does it work?
No. After production, there's a filming. There's two sides to it. We have principal photography, where I film with all of the actors and get all of that shot. And then there's a little, like, 3 weeks of additional photography where I went out and I filmed various places in Los Angeles and San Diego of areas of Los Angeles that hadn't been touched by modern times, where there's still old architecture and old buildings. And I filmed those, and what I couldn't find, I built in miniature form, and I filmed that. And then sort of put it all together and superimposed the actors into this, in front of this footage, and created this whole world for the Dr. Mabuse story to take place in.
Okay, Nathan, how was it for you? Because I imagine each time you have a new scene, maybe they have, like, to move the X's or something, so you move a different direction or something?
Not really. I mean, there was maybe different spots on the wall that I would be looking at, but it was quite interesting. This is one of my first projects with a blue screen as well. And it's like, Ansel would be like, all right, now you're going to be looking over this, and this is a city, and just keep looking at that spot, and then this is kind of what's going on. And you're sitting there like, all right, trying to soak it in of like, okay, I'm in this spot, and all this stuff is going on, and now I have to deliver my lines very passionately to this dot that is on this wall. And so you get to use your imagination, I guess, for sure, when you're doing blue screen.
Which, it's called acting.
Yep, it's called acting. So, but it's very good just for, I guess, to build my acting abilities to be able to do that. So it was interesting, and sometimes it's better to have somebody there, but it works.
Yeah.
They were losing their minds by the time.
Yeah.
The end of filming, just being surrounded by
blue. It's kind of odd.
Yeah.
Who was it? The one that did? She was the fairy for Peter Pan with Robin Williams, and she said she almost went nuts by the end of the movie because everything she did was alone. She never actually interacted with anybody. She was in this little green room by herself. We do have one question: does it make a difference for a green or blue screen?
No, not really. It's sort of the aesthetic choice of the filmmaker. A lot of the times now they use green screen. It depends on, you know, what you want to look at for, you know, 7 days a week or, you know, 9 to 5, if you want to look at color green or the color blue. Green is kind of, I don't know, it's harder on your eyes. You start seeing red everywhere because green and red are like the opposite colors. So blue, I thought, would be much easier to deal with. Rather than looking at green all day. So, no, there's no difference. You could use any color that you wanted, actually.
Right. You know, screw with them and use a different one every day.
Yeah.
You know? Did somebody slip something into the water?
With the blue screen. Oh, sorry. But that's the thing, too, when you're acting with the blue screen, is Ansel will tell you what's behind you and everything, and you're trying to imagine it. And I think in the film, what Ansel brought to the film was a lot better than I actually was even imagining. So it was great props to Ansel for bringing that to the film.
cool. Another question, did Ansel do storyboards for the film?
No. I do not believe in storyboards, actually. I know a lot of directors do. I will only do storyboards on the rare occasion that there's a very complicated visual effect that I have to do. But I usually like to see what the actors are going to do, and then the thing with blue screen, you don't have to worry about where you're going to put the camera if you're going to be filming this side of the corner of the room or whatnot. You just film the actors. So I usually let the actors do what they want to do, see what they're going to do, give them some notes on it, put the camera aiming at them, film it, and then the magic of blue screen, I can, you know, put them wherever I want them to be. So, no, I see no purpose for storyboards at the moment. Mm-hmm. That may change in, you know, 5 to 10 years, but no, I didn't do storyboards on Doctrine of Abuse.
Okay, now let's get to the acting, and it's work. I mean, let's face it, there's money riding on this, there's professions riding on this, and you're all, I would imagine, perfectionists. You want the best that you can possibly do. So, fun, was there cut-up time? Was there anything that happened that made you belly laugh? You know, was there, anything that happened that, you know, and I'm going to drag this out. Sorry, Jerry. Well, everybody remembers Barnabas coming into the scene yelling, Julia, Julia, and a fly flies in his mouth. Or you hear somebody come in and then the whole backdrop fell behind him, you know, but that was live TV, you know, and all that. You know, any good stories we can hear?
Well, you know, we didn't have any real furniture or props there. Everything, we just the blue drapes all around. So there wasn't too much that could go wrong.
I think the only thing that actually happened that you could say was mildly funny was we were filming a very intense scene and we hear this weird pounding, and we go outside and it was two squirrels getting it on the roof. And that held us up for about half an hour. But that was, I don't think there was much that really sort of, nothing too funny happened. I don't know, maybe Nate and Derek can answer this better than I can. I was too busy going crazy trying to make the movie.
I don't think I don't have any funny stories, unfortunately. I carried a lot of my energy off screen as well. So it probably made for a bad friendship between Jerry and I. I have to rekindle in the future.
I guess for me, there wasn't really too many things because we were being pretty professional. But yeah. I mean, I guess a lot of the times where we'd get a good chuckle was just where you're sitting there and having this moment with this person, and you're like going back and forth, and then you know, just all of a sudden your lines are just gone, and you're just blank, and you're like. You try to keep going on, but then the moment passes and you just start laughing and you screwed up the scene, so
and
you
just
do it
think,
again.
They realize how ridiculous the moment is.
How ridiculous, how kind of funny it is that we're doing this.
In 20 years, you'll be on blooper reels on YouTube where, like, they have Bogart saying, and I can't remember my goddamn lines, you know, or you see... Betty Davis going, help, 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 my dress is stuck, you know?
Yeah. And it's gone. I just blanked.
Well, you might actually be seeing those bloopers on the DVD of Dr. Mabuse when it comes out later this fall. It might be a bit sooner than 20 years. But, there was nothing really distracting when we were filming. I mean, we would film one scene, we'd get it done, and we'd move on to the next thing. That was just constant work, but it went rather quickly, so...
But it was very fun.
Yeah, I mean,
by the
fun.
Way,
I mean,
it wasn't
Yeah,
things have changed in movie making. I remember the story of Boris Karloff when he was doing Frankenstein and whales made them take a leak in a bucket in the corner of the room because he didn't want to lose time, you know? I mean, really, you know?
Let me do that on the next movie.
Yep.
There you go. Get even.
Thanks for the idea.
Yeah, if you can't be creative, get even, right?
Yeah.
Working with the ladies, Jerry, what was it like working with the ladies again?
Which ladies?
Laura and Catherine.
Well, we've been working intermittently on these Big Finish production audio dramas on CDs. So, and then of course we've been in touch socially over the years. So, it wasn't like a big new thing. But they're great professionals, and it's always fun to work with them. Lara and I have been doing a number of these CDs, and we've become sort of jokingly referred to as the Nick and Nora of Big Finish Productions, because Angelique has become a private detective along with Tony Peterson, and they go around the world solving crimes, occult crime.
Wow, that's cool. And Big Finish is tell the listeners what Big Finish is and where they can find them.
Big Finish Productions is a British company. They make CDs of Dark Shadows and Doctor Who and some other things. I don't know, where do you find them? I suppose online, like everything else. Put in Big Finish Productions, yeah, Dark Shadows, and I'm sure they'll come up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of them are continuations of stories, which again goes back to it's just never going to die. I'm amazed at Dark Shadows. When I came back from California, I guess in 72, almost 73, and there were the movies and all, I was kind of surprised, you know. I just was like, are you kidding me, you know? But it was a good show because Curtis was brilliant. He went and he took all the horror stories and the movies that were out, Damien, that type of thing, ended up being that whole thing with Jeb and all them, and he took all the stories and used them, recycled them, and what's
right.
His name, Fred said some of them he recycled 2 and 3 times.
Yes.
But it paid the bills for a long time. I have a question, and I'm going to read it as I'm reading it because the chat's moving. I don't want to lose it. Mo, when they were shooting in front of the blue screen, did they have a monitor to see what was happening in the background?
No. The background of, like, what was going to be behind them? Because no. there was no background that was sort of showing up behind them. It was just blue.
It was just straight blue curtain behind us and in front of us, and he would maybe tell us a little bit what he thought, like if there was going to be a building back there or a house or a hall, and go. That was pretty much it. That was it.
That's imagination, because, I mean, basically, did you guys watch it after you shot it, and there's the blue behind you? Because no?
I would not let them see any of it, actually, until this Saturday, unless they absolutely needed to, if they had to dub something. But even then, I was very reluctant to let any of the cast see anything of the film. I'm quite secretive with stuff until it's ready to be screened.
What a stinker.
They had no opportunity to see it until Saturday.
You guys all had to sweat this out.
It was a great exercise in our imagination.
Yeah. It was nerve-wracking.
How bad was it? Because I would have wanted to see, you know, see what it looked like at least, you know, before the big day, you know. I mean, even a private viewing, okay, just let us all get there. You know, it's like that Ed Wood movie, you know, where they all get the stuff thrown at them, and Bela Lugosi says, now that was an opening, you know.
Yeah.
And they were, like, trying to crawl out of the place, you know. I mean, that's kind of a stinky thing to do, Ansel. I didn't know you had it in you.
Thank you. Thank you for backing us up.
They were pleading with me to let them see something, and I kept saying no. And I had a test screening in Hollywood, and they unfortunately found out where it was, and I told the theater manager, if you see two guys that come up and they say they're involved in the film, you can't let them in the theater.
Yeah, Nate and I joked about showing up about, there.
Yeah, that we were going to show up and just sit in the back or somehow break in and check it out. But
we did see the first 30 seconds about a month ago, and then...
But it was just the titles. It still wasn't actual footage. Mm.
And we asked a question, and then he shut it off.
Oh, wow. You see, you guys missed a golden opportunity. Jerry's very good at walling people up.
Yeah,
you know, you could have just got him on your side and said, look, we're going to do this. We're going to see this. Another question, the background was added later then after all the filming was done?
Yes. Yeah, it was.
So how much time did all of this take? I asked Sal Litvak, and he said from the day the concept of Saving Lincoln came into his head and his wife's head, they found all these incredible pictures in the archives, to the day it was released to the public, and I don't even know if that's the right word, it was 11 years for him. Ansel, how long of a trek has this been from your first concept of, yeah, I want to do this about this psychotic mind bender, and then to where you are today?
From the very, very first concept of when the story came to me, when it just popped in my head, I was 14 years old. I am now 21 years old. So, who's good at math here? I'm terrible at math.
That's 7 years.
7 years, yeah. So 7 years from early concept to reality, but from production to reality, about a year, really. We started filming on June 3rd of last year, and the movie's coming out this Friday in Los Angeles, so it's almost a year of work.
Mm.
It was a labor of love.
And let me ask, I don't know, I haven't seen it yet, and I'm dying to see it, so I don't know how many of you were all together in one scene or anything. Did you have trouble with logistics and getting everybody? Because I don't know how it's made. Some people make their films, they start with the beginning and end at the end, and others jump around to different scenes to accommodate who can be where at what time. Were you all in the general area? Did that make it easier?
Yeah, we filmed out of sequence. We filmed, you know, I go by who can I get on what day. So there was, you know, a day where we just filmed solely with Derek and Jerry. And then there was a day where I had almost the entire cast on set. But that didn't necessarily mean they were in the same scene together. They were just waiting to do a scene with each other. So it really, we jumped around
most of it though, I mean, we did jump around a little bit, but we did pretty much start in the beginning almost, and then like one of the last scenes of the actual movie. So we didn't jump around from like do the end and then do the beginning and the end. We pretty much started with the beginning of the movie and then kind of worked as much as we possibly could to the end of the script, to the end of the movie.
It wasn't 100% linear, but it was sequential in some areas.
Yeah.
And this is a very dark drama type, noir type of thing.
History,
but
yeah.
There is a there's a séance type of scene in it.
I'm sorry, Mo. What was that again?
A séance type of scene.
There,
I see the lore.
There is something like that.
There's something like that.
There's something like that. That it is involved with Kathryn Lee Scott, Laura Parker, and Lyndon Childs, who plays the former inspector that was on Mabuse's case.
Okay.
See glimpses of it in the trailer. You'll have to see the movie in order to find out what it really is.
Hmm. I like when she says, be careful, Inspector, you know, these are strange times. Jerry, did you find the story, when he came to you and said, here's the script, was it totally finished and you just read the whole script and you were on board? Did you like it?
Yes, I liked it very much right away. It was it was a lot more in depth than I expected from someone his age, and had a lot more detail and a lot more. I don't know how to describe that. He has a lot of twists and little clues and things in there that all add up. Very sophisticated script.
Very cool. Ansel, let me ask right now, didn't you have any pets or friends or sports or tinker toys when you were a kid? I mean, you know, you're 14 years old and you're thinking about making movies, you know? Did you have, like, you know, polio and you were stuck in a chair or something here?
No, thank God I didn't have polio. But
I think he had pets and all those things, but then he put them in his movies.
Yeah, well, I don't know. Dr. Mabuse is a very, very dark film, and the story came to me when I was 14, so that must tell you something about what I was like when I was 14. sort of
heavy metal music.
No,
heavy metal music.
Sort of the loner misanthrope in high school that, you know, nobody understood. And I don't want to sound like I'm feeling sorry for myself.
Maybe introvert
like
is
yeah,
introvert.
Very much of an introvert, and definitely not in with the times. You know, people would talk to me about some singer or whatever, something, you know, that was happening in, you know, 2006 or what have you, and I'd have no idea what they're talking about, and then I'd start talking about something that happened in 1925, and they'd have no idea what I was talking about. So, yeah, that's where I came from. I think I've progressed considerably since. I hope, at least.
I think I heard somewhere that Ansel had some Legos when he was young, but he made figures out of them and made movies with them.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Really, because I have to tell you, when my sons were 14, I usually found Penthouse, Playboy, Hit Someplace, and that was, you know, making movies or doing anything constructive, like even homework, was not happening.
Oh, yeah, homework,
so, I mean, 14-year-old boys are rough.
Today I was at the market, and school had just gotten out, and this mother and son were walking. They just checked out, and they were going to the Red Box. And the mom said, did you have homework tonight? And the kid said, yes, I do. And she goes, well, you're not watching any movies until you finish your homework. And now, I have great respect for our war veterans, and they are heroes, and they served this country well. But school, to me, was my Vietnam. I had a flashback when she said, you're not watching anything until you do your homework. Because I hated school, and I hated homework work. So,
yes.
That's, yeah.
You would have just lied and said that you didn't have homework.
And I did several times, so I could go and write my scripts and be left alone in my little imaginative world.
Yeah, Jesus, don't we have to go to church today or something? You know, I can go pray to God, you know, maybe that'll work. We're going to go to break, and we're going to play another Bill Wandel, and this is the conclusion piece of music from the movie, which it's all very eerie, and the score is really cool. We'll be right back. I hope everybody's enjoying our guest tonight, and we'll be back in like 3-4 minutes.
This is Michelle Tomlinson, the Scream Queen, and I listen to GameCon Radio. Why? Because it rocks!
¶¶
and our guests tonight have been phenomenal. I was just saying to Jerry, because he is the seasoned veteran actor, that I had never been to a Dark Shadows festival. I had no clue they had these festivals. And then, of course, when we had Lara and Catherine on, and Chris Pennick and all, and they were saying, you got to go to one. I went, and Jonathan Frid passed away last year in April. He was supposed to be the special guest and do a film kind of history and presentation, and instead Nancy Barrett and Jerry Lacy jumped in and did an improv, which Jerry, I understand, wrote, and it was the two characters meeting all these years later, and of course they are plagued with the glasses. And they're sitting back to back, so they don't see each other's faces. And he's talking about, yeah, I used to date a girl from this town. And finally, she grabs her glasses, puts it around, and shoots and looks at him. It was really cute, and everybody enjoyed it. But, you know, talented people, you know, when you put someone like Jerry Lacy and Nancy Barrett together, and with that talent, they pulled it off. It was really good, and I very much enjoyed it. I plan on going to the one that they're going to have, I think, at Lyndhurst again in July. You know, it's a lot of fun and great memories and everything. Our other guests are Derek and Nathan, and of course, we have Ansel on. And let me ask you guys, Jerry, has it changed a lot? Did you have anything that you thought, oh, this is a little bit different than I'm used to, or did you fall right in with them? Because it was a young cast, right?
You're talking about the movie?
The movie, Mabuse. I mean, it's a very young cast, and you were the seasoned guy, you and Lara and Catherine and a few others. You know, it's kind of like this generation meets that, huh?
Well, not really. There were other people in the cast too who were older. Lyndon Childs mm-hmm. has been around for mm-hmm. Even longer than I have, and
yeah.
he's wonderful in the movie also. You know, whenever you do a project, there are young people in it and older people. You know, the generations are usually well represented. I've done worked with children from time to time, so no, it's mm-hmm. everybody's. I think everyone, you know, they're just actors. They're actors, mm-hmm. and they're whatever age they are doesn't really have a lot to do with it. It's the talent that they're demonstrating mm-hmm. at the time that really counts.
Yeah, Sharon Lentz, she played Sarah in Dark Shadows, and she was
yeah.
a baby. Dave, yeah, the kid that played David, he was a baby. I mean,
yeah.
You know, so, you know, the only thing you don't ever want to do is act with Muppets. You know, then your career's over, you know. There's no way to upstage a Muppet, man. I mean, once you act with Kermit, you're dead in the water. How about you guys? Was there any, like, oh, my God, these guys, you know... Was there any for a minute stage fright with the older generation at all?
Yes. Very terrifying.
Yes.
Working with actors with a lot more clout than especially myself. But Jerry is the most generous actor I've ever worked with, and he made it easy, but on the inside I was terrified with agonizing pain. But it was...
But I think in the beginning, I mean, when you look at, like, how much they've all done, you're going to get a little nervous because they are veterans. They've, you know, been around. They've done so much that you just, I think most of it was just anxious that you want to be up to their capabilities, or you want to
right.
rise to where they are, try to be at their level, which is tough to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I think just those nerves of the not knowing if you can get there, or do you have the talent to, like, be with these great actors, and it was great working with them and just being around them, because they were all so generous and you learn so much by acting with them or just watching from the sidelines, and the things that they do, the little things that they do that makes the perfect sense when you're watching the film. It's really great to see.
Yeah, and I give a credit mm-hmm. to Ansel for having theatrically trained actors. You know, because there are some seasoned actors who may not have as good of skills, and we were fortunate enough to have amazing talent.
And then we have, yeah, and it seems like watching the film is it's a great cast to be around, and
right.
it kind of went very harmoniously throughout the whole shoot. Sometimes you work on some shoots and there's quite a few problems. You have some problems with some actors, you have some problems with the sets or whatever is going on, time, but everybody seemed always very professional. Everybody was always being there when they had to be, and it's a pretty seamless project, and it kind of seems to make it a little special. When something like that happens, it seems like you know you have something good.
And how did this work for you, Ansel, with learning?
Well, as Derek said, it was quite terrifying at first to work with Jerry, Catherine, and Laura. But I figured, you know what, I have to direct them. I can't, you know,
right.
because I was looking at them initially as a fan. I wanted to work with them mm-hmm. not as, you know, a fan, but as actors. I respected their body of work and all three of their amazing talents, you know, mm-hmm. separated from Dark Shadows. They've done, I mean, as we all know, Jerry in Played Again, Sam, and countless other things, and Catherine in Great Gatsby, and Laura in Save the mm-hmm. Tiger and Race with the Devil. So I wanted to work with them as actors. Of course, when initially you meet them, you're looking at them as their Dark Shadows characters, and they're a bit scary and intimidating. But you have to get over that, and you have to say, I have to direct these people. I have to tell them what to do. So you get over it, and you get on with the work. And as I said earlier, working with them, they bring so much. They know how to do it that you don't have to tell them really what to do. You just point the camera at them and let them have at it. And even the younger cast members, everybody just kind of gelled. You know, everybody seemed like it. We really kind of became like a little family, a little sort of a troupe of actors, you know, all working together
mm-hmm.
you know, to make this film. And there was no sort of I'm the bigger actor, so you know you gotta get out of my way so I can, you know,
do my thing
mm-hmm. you know. Everybody just kind of
no center of the world.
Yeah,
everybody
yeah.
was
everybody helped
equal.
Each other out. Everybody
yeah.
was
yeah.
very giving
very
with their lines, and yes.
And as a director, that's so I was eternally grateful to have that, because you know I've been on shoots where things can go wrong and egos get in the way, and it's the worst thing to have to deal with as a director. You're trying to make a movie, but you're also trying to keep everybody from killing each other. And on Dr. Mabuse,
right.
everybody was just phenomenal to work with, not only in their work ethics, but in the performances that they were giving me, and I could not be happier. I still am. Mm-hmm. I can't believe really what a great cast I have on the film.
You know, you remind me of James Garner in his book talking about Mel Gibson working with him in Maverick, and he said the guy drove him crazy. He never remembered any of his lines and would constantly ad-lib. You know, and there's a lot of actors who do that. They don't ever learn the actual script. They just kind of ad-lib what it's basically about, you know? And he said it just drove him nuts that he really didn't want to work with them again after that because of it, you know? So it's really important to have people remembering their lines. Let me ask you just, and then we're going to let Ansel talk about where we can see it and everything else and about where the site is and all. Did any of you guys suggest changes in any of the script and say, you know, maybe this would work better, or did you all just kind of fall in and use the lines written? Crickets.
Derek could probably answer that one a little bit.
Yeah.
Nobody's going to say nothing. Even if you did, you're not going to say
well,
anything, are you?
He can chime in on that.
Well, I had a few line changes that I asked Ansel if we could do. I won't, you know, don't want to go into them right now because they might give too much of the story away for, you know,
right.
people are going to watch it. They don't want to be told ahead of time. But there were some, mm-hmm. so, you remember, Ansel? Do you know what I'm talking about?
It was like very sort of minor moments. It wasn't anything like, I want a new scene. It was like, can we just change the
Can we just change the way this is said?
Yeah.
Maybe, you know?
That's,
yeah,
that's
and that's
right.
cool
that's...
because it's all part of the creative gel, and you're all creating one thing. You know, you're like a lot of scientists making an invention, you know, and everybody's got to put something of themselves into it. Jerry, what do you got coming up next for you?
Oh, I don't have anything lined up right now.
Vacation?
No, just auditioning and looking for another job. Mm-hmm. That's what actors do most of the time, is look for jobs.
Well, but
yes,
Jerry, you sort of do kind of have something lined up, but...
Well, there's the sequel to Dr. Mabuse, of course, this summer.
There we go, there we go, there we go. There's a sequel. So, Ansel, what is the sequel? When are you going to start working on it?
Well, we're already in the middle of pre-production. You know, we got the film cast and whatnot, and we have we begin filming. Tomorrow is May 1st. We begin filming June 1st. I can't remember, but the very first week of June we start production, and hopefully we'll have it out for next summer. But we've been working at it since October. Actually, as soon as we knew Dr. Mabuse won, there was enough interest that we could do a sequel. We started working on it, but we really cannot mm-hmm. talk about that. But
right,
yeah.
Okay, so you're going to do a sequel to the movie, and are Nathan going to be in it?
People oh, sure he is.
Back. We don't know yet.
People
okay.
are coming back.
Okay,
that's how we'll answer that.
Okay, people are coming back. There's just one Apocalypse Man. He's the guy with the end of the world signs, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
John C. Smith plays the Apocalypse
cool.
Man and does a marvelous job at it too.
Yeah, he's very very creepy looking. You know,
yes.
he's the guy you don't want coming to Thanksgiving dinner.
He's our Peter Lorre in the film.
Yeah. Yeah. Where are they going to be able to see this movie? How is it going to be distributed?
Well, the first Dr. Mabuse will be, it opens at the Los Feliz 3 Cinema on Vermont Avenue in Los Angeles, California. It starts screening at midnight this Friday, May 3rd and May 4th. There's four showings of the film, May 3rd and May 4th at midnight, Friday and Saturday, and then the following Friday and Saturday, May 10th and May 11th, also at the Los Feliz 3 Cinema in Los Angeles. And hopefully
mm-hmm.
we will have more screenings over the summer, hopefully in New York, hopefully across the country. And then in November, the film will be coming out on DVD and Blu-ray. And, but this Friday is going to be our official theatrical release, and we are all going to be there at Los Feliz. If you guys want to come down and say, if anybody who's listening is in the Los Angeles area, and is listening and wants to come by and say hi and meet us, we're going to be there, the entire cast. And it's going to be a lot of fun. And
come check it out.
Yeah,
please.
come check it out. Come support this small independent film. And, you know, we hope that
you enjoy it as much as we did making it.
Yeah, and that more people will be able to see it as we go along through the summer.
And let me ask, because you know, a lot of the actors and Seagal, different ones like that, they're going straight to DVD now because you know, it's just I think a lot of theaters are having trouble selling seats. You know, I mean, for me and Teddy to go to a movie, it's $60. You know, I'm in New Jersey. You know, and so it's a little rough. Are you going to go right to DVD after you're done screening it and all?
Yes, I mean, it's going to be later on in the year, but I do have to say we are incredibly lucky to have gotten a theatrical release, even if it is in Los Angeles. That's I have to speak, you know, I have to brag a little bit here for just a moment, so bear with me, but it's a huge achievement.
Go ahead.
On all of us to get that theatrical release, and I really have to thank Jim Pearson and Lance Alsbaugh for granting us this moment to shine in cinemas, or in a cinema at least.
Mm-hmm.
To say that our film had a theatrical run, even if it was only for two mm-hmm. weekends. So, but then we will be going to DVD national release in November, and wherever you are, New Jersey, Texas, Minnesota, you will find the film available on DVD and Blu-ray.
Mm-hmm. I really would like to, Ghost in the chat is saying, it sounds like a huge achievement, and I have to say, for a 21-year-old kitty, I'm not being disrespectful, you're only 4 years older than my granddaughter, for crying out loud. It is a huge achievement for you, and you've got a wonderful cast there. All you sound, I've met Jerry, but I mean, you young men sound like, as Karloff said, you have the fire in the belly, and that's really important. I'm impressed by all of you. And Jerry, I think you're impressed by all of them too, right?
I definitely am. Absolutely.
Yeah. I want to thank you all for coming on, and please tell them the site where they can check everything out. You go on YouTube, you can watch the trailer, Dr. Mabuse 2013. That's how I always get it. You just type in Dr. Mabuse, M-A-B-U-S-E, 2013, and all kinds of things come up. But where's your site, and where do you want them to go to check it out?
Our official site is www.drmabuse.com, and you can find all sorts of information on the film there. But if you want instant, up-to-date notifications, find us on Facebook. Just type up Dr. Mabuse 2013, and you should find us. You can't miss it. There's a picture of Jerry Lacy and Catherine Lee Scott and Laura Parker and Nathan Wilson on there, and that's where you're going to get probably your most up-to-date knowledge on the film. If there's any additional screenings or, you know, prizes or whatever, what have you, you'll find it there. And also on YouTube, you can find the trailer. There's three trailers and a little featurette interview with myself and Nate talking about the film, and mm-hmm. you can also see some of my early work. And And the film, once again, it will be playing at the Los Feliz 3 Cinema in Los Angeles, California, May 3rd, May 4th, May 10th, and May 11th. Those are Fridays and Saturdays, and they're all midnight screenings. And it's going to be a lot of fun, and we're really glad that we've been given this opportunity. I'm really glad that I've been given this opportunity to work with Jerry, Catherine, Laura, and with this new group of talent who are amazing. And I'm really looking forward to working with all of them again in the second film. And I'm going to thank you, Mo, again, for letting me come back on and promote my small film. It's been an amazing experience from beginning to end. And I can't wait to see what we're going to do next. So that's my pitch.
Mm-hmm. Jerry, do you want? And Nate, you were interviewed by Fangora. And do you have a site?
I do not have a website yet. I should probably make one of those very, very
soon.
Got a
Facebook?
I do have a Facebook. It's under Nathan Wilson. You can go and check it out there. I have a bunch of information. That's what's going on with the film and everything that's going on with me as well right now. If you want to check out the mm-hmm. Fangora interview that I had, you can type up, I think, just Dr. Mabuse and Nathan Wilson under Google, and I think one of the first things that pops up is my interview with Fangora mm-hmm. magazine, and it talks about the film. Little bit talked about myself, and
mm-hmm.
and I have a,
yeah,
some
a good
trailers
Derek,
and other things on YouTube as well.
Okay, Derek, you got a Facebook, a site?
I do have a Facebook and a very limited IMDb, but I assume more will happen in the future. But just Facebook, yes, Derek Mo Broughton.
you will find
mm-hmm. it. And Jerry, you have a site, so share with everybody your site.
Well, it's called Friends of Jerry Lacy on Facebook, and it's got hundreds of pictures and lots of data on there, and also you can reach Gloria Lillibridge through there, I think, if you want to get a CD or any of the other stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and the CD is to help animals in shelters. And Jerry picks a different one each time, and it's a really worthy cause, and we all love animals, and we all hurt for animals, so everybody, try to, jump in there and do your bit, too. I want to thank you all for coming on. This was a lovely evening. God bless you all. I hope that this is a great success for you, and I know everybody's going to love it that sees it.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Mo.
And thank you. All you guys have to do is hang up. And like I said, by tomorrow morning, I'll have it up on podcast. You can download it. And, Ansel, get it to everybody. And you can use it wherever you want. Okay?
All right.
Thank you
very much. Thanks again, Mo.
Thank you, and good night. God bless.
Good night.
All you got to do is hang up the phone.
Okay. All right.
Good night. This was a great show. I can't tell you how much I enjoyed doing all this, talking to these four handsome gentlemen. Jesus, I had a great night tonight. Four honeys on my show. Very cool. And it's Dr. Mabuse 2013. I suspect we are going to see some huge things in the future from Ansel and Nathan and Derek. We've already seen incredible things by Jerry, Laura, and Catherine. Great talent. A really incredible talent. And like the movie says, don't let him get into your head. He's a really bad guy. You don't want this guy messing with your head. Next week, we're going to have Carolyn Quinn on. Carolyn Quinn has wrote a book called Mama Rose's Turn, The True Story of America's Most Notorious Stage Mother, the mother of Gypsy Rose Lee. And for anybody who doesn't know, Gypsy Rose Lee was a stripper. And there was a movie made about her. Her mother literally drove her to the point of breaking. The mother always wanted to be a famous theater actress or something, and ended up using her daughter to try to get fame and money and everything, to the point of almost destroying her. It's a great book. And I think you guys are all going to be very interested in how... she came by all her information, which started just with a few curiosities. You know, when she saw the movie Gypsy Rose Lee, it struck some, she started asking some questions, and one thing led to another. And the next thing she knew, she was writing a book. So that's it. And then we're going to have on the 21st, Kathy Benjamin. She's in England, and she's written a book called Funerals to Die For. And some of them have some really odd, it's a book about all the odder, more elaborate things people are doing and have done for funerals, from posing their loved ones on motorcycles to elaborate stagings and customs, different customs all over the world. So that should be a lot of fun. And then we're going to have Road to Sailor. And his book is The Boat, and it's a religious book talking about faith and truths and that kind of thing. That's on the 28th. Then I think we're going to the 11th and June, and we are going to have the great-granddaughter of Molly Brown, the unsinkable Molly Brown, who was on the Titanic. Her great-granddaughter is going to come on and talk about her. She was not a a hayseed. She spoke several languages. She could carry herself in front of kings and queens in other countries. And in the movies, they kind of tend to make her look like some hayseed who never had a bathtub in the house or indoor plumbing, as we call it. So I think this is going to be a really interesting show because this is a direct relative of her, and she knows the woman and, what she was really like. And then on the 18th, David Brown, Captain David Brown, is coming back to talk about his grandfather's Civil War experiences. They have some artifacts from his grandfather's service, and one of them happens to be one of the bullets that was in his grandfather's leg. And then we're going to have another guest on the 25th, Chris Kravatin, and he's the author of Grave Diggers. It's a book. It's like a Stephen King type of storybook, but it's called Grave Diggers. So we've got, a lot of shows coming up, a lot of great guests. If you have a guest you would like to have on the lair, you got to get a hold of me at asylumsgate.com. And it's a free registration. All you got to do is contact me there, Mo Banshee. And I do have a Facebook. It's called Mo Banshee Asylum, and you can get me there. And if you want to hear a specific guest, let me know. Let me know who you want to have on. I'll be happy to have them on. Again, a huge thank you to our guests this evening, Jerry Lacy, Ansel Faraj, Nathan Wilson and Derek Mobratton, the actors and director and writer from Dr. Mabuse 2013. And with that, I'm going to close out the show. God bless you all. Thank everybody for listening. And please send our links around so, more people listen in. I'd like to see if we could crash this station. It's scary, but we've done it. But I'd like to try it again. So, God bless you all. I love you all. And let me see. Good night. Thank you for visiting me at my lair. You can always contact me at www.asylumsgate.com. Again, thank you for visiting, and God bless you and yours. Ha, 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 ha.